I'm Lori.
And I'm Cindy.
And we're keeping up with the Jones Girls. So what are we doing today, Sin?
We're going in here to the Wildlife Park in Kamloops, BC, and we're going to talk to Glenn. Glenn is going to give us a bunch of information on all these animals, and we're going to see all the animals.
I'm really excited. So, ready to go?
I am sure ready to go.
Join us. So we're so excited to be here with Glenn Grant at the BC Wildlife Park in Kamloops. And Glenn, you are the
Executive Director.
The Executive Director. Yeah. So tell us a little bit, how long have you been at the Wildlife?
I've been here for 20 years. I've seen an awful lot of changes over that time.
I bet.
I was hired years ago when the park made a decision to be a tourist destination as opposed to just a local attraction. We wanted to showcase all of British Columbia and all the wildlife of British Columbia. So we needed to develop the park in order to do that. So, and we've come a long way.
And how long has the park been here?
The park is now 51 years old. It's been here a long time. The society started back in 1964, but opened to the public in 65. So we've, again, there's lots of history here. You know, all this land was donated by Molson Breweries.
And the beer company?
The beer company, yep.
Oh, yay, Molson.
Yep. It used to be hop farms. So years ago, Molson donated it to the society to start a wildlife park.
Uh-huh.
And then years later, the society then transferred the land over to the city of Kamloops. So this is all owned by the city of Kamloops. And we operate it through a lease agreement. So
it's really big here.
Yes, it is. Actually, we have a little over 100 acres, so there's lots of space still that's undeveloped. All the area, basically everywhere you can see around it, all the hillsides on the east side are all part of the park's property. And a little bit of crown land that we have a lease for, that we have some nature trails and stuff so people can spend a lot of time here. We want people to come early, stay late, and have lots of different activities to do.
Well, it's really sort of like the animals would actually live. Right? Everything is exactly the natural of way that they would live in BC.
That's what we're trying to do. And again, behind us here, this is Clover's enclosure, the very elusive clover that we're trying to
It's like finding a four-leaf clover. Yeah. We're looking for clover.
Finding a needle in a haystack sometimes. Yeah. But again, this habitat is just under 3 acres in size.
Just his.
There's a lot of space for a bear. But again, he comes from the rainforest and we're in a desert. So How can we mimic that? What we need to do is put it in an area that was lots of trees, lots of shade. We have a little man-made lake that's here. There's another pool on the other side of the enclosure with this little river that runs down between it. So he's got lots of water.
So he's right at home.
He's very, very much at home.
So tell us a little bit about Clover.
Clover. Well, he's a male bear. He's 5 years old. He's a black bear with a recessive gene that makes his coat white.
So he's pure white.
It's kind of more like... you know the clover flower, so the little kind of cinnamon color that's on a clover flower, he's that color.
Oh.
So hence name Clover. He looks like a clover flower. So he's not pure white, he's not like a polar bear, he is kind of like a light tan color.
Well, and I think that's what people think is a white bear, that he's a polar bear, but he's not a polar bear.
He's not a polar bear. He's a black bear with a recessive gene.
And how old was he when he came here?
He was just under two when he first came here, about a year and a half when he came here. But again, he was an orphan. He went to a rehabilitation center in Smithers called Northern Lights, and the whole idea was to release him back to the wild.
Okay.
They had done that. It wasn't successful. When he was recaptured again, they put a radio collar on him that was sponsored by Spirit Bear Coffee Company, which is kind of cool. And so once they released him again, he lost his collar, came across a work camp that they had no idea was in the area. And again, the folks at the camp started feeding him. And once the bear's habituated that much to humans providing food, he's going to be a problem bear. So because he was white, because he's our official provincial mammal, and he's protected, the ministry thought at the time it would be best if he came here to serve as an ambassador. So he's the only one in the world that is in human care. So we're very lucky to have him here.
I'm looking at the tree over there where you were telling us that's where he climbs up, his favorite tree there.
Yep, it is. That
is his favorite. He's taking all the bark off.
All the bark is off of it. And again, there's a reason for that. And unbeknownst to us, we didn't design the habitat with this in mind.
Yeah.
But years ago, before we built this, the roadway came through about where we're standing, and everything to the east or over that way where his favorite tree is, was the elk habitat.
Oh.
So we had to redo some, make the elk habitat a little bit larger and move it a little bit further over.
Yeah.
So this is where the elk were rubbing up against that tree. So there was lots of scents and different things for him to explore. So naturally he kind of gravitated over over to that way. And then now he kind of, that's one of his favorite hangouts.
Oh.
So it's kind of cool.
Yeah. So going back, I was going to talk a little bit about how the animals get to the wildlife park.
Well, there's a few different ways that they come here. One is through our rehabilitation center. We've got a very large rehabilitation center. We have a release rate of about 36-37% of everything that comes in does make its way back to the wild.
So that's
last year we took in just under 500 animals.
So that would be if I found an animal that was hurt or something, then I would call the wildlife park. Or would I call the game warden?
Well, you would either bring it to us, call us and bring it to us, or the conservation officers will get it and bring it to us. And if it's deemed to be, has an injury that it won't survive in the wild, i.e. some of our eagles have a broken wing, the wing won't heal properly, it can't fly.
Right.
Beautiful, healthy bird.
Yes.
But, you know, it's not going to survive.
Right.
We'll give it a home.
Perfect.
Clover, he was an orphan. Our grizzly bears were orphans. That aren't going to survive in the wild. So again, they were brought here. The other way that we can acquire animals is if they're born in captivity in another facility.
Okay.
And a good example is our moose. Her name is Cherry. She was born at the Toronto Zoo. And when she was young, was transferred to the Assiniboine Zoo in Winnipeg. And as they're doing a lot of development there for their new Arctic and Gateway to the North exhibition, all that traffic, the excavators, the dump trucks, the cement trucks, all that stuff is invasive to an animal that's in the vicinity.
Yes.
So
yes.
The best thing for that animal, Winnipeg thought, was to transfer it someplace like ours, that it would have a lot more space and be a little tranquil
more
location.
At home.
More at home.
More at home.
So that's how we acquired our moose. Same thing with the wolves. Our wolves were born in captivity in a zoo in Quebec. So there is a transfer around the facilities, like all CASA accredited facilities like that. Mm-hmm. So that's how the collection comes
here. It's good to know, right? That's good to know.
Yes, we would never trap or we never would ever accept an animal that is healthy to live in the wild.
Exactly.
If that's where it belongs first.
Right.
And if it can't, then we'll give it a home.
And that's why they're blessed to have wildlife parks.
Yes.
So are there volunteer opportunities for people in the area, in Kamloops area, to come out?
Countless.
I can't imagine working in a place like this every day.
You know, it's pretty cool. Even today, instead of sitting at a computer, it's great to walk around with you and talk about the park a little bit.
Yeah.
But volunteer opportunities are endless. And it doesn't matter what your field of interest is. If you're a horticulturist and want to come help, do some landscape areas, we welcome that. There's the folks that just want to help do animal food prep. So they work with the zookeepers in the commissary, providing all the daily diets. We have keepers that are volunteers that want to shadow our keepers and help with some enclosure maintenance and weed whipping or sometimes with a shovel and a wheelbarrow going through some of the enclosures. It's all work that needs to be done. Education-wise, if you want to help with kids' camps or face painting or whatever it is, there's endless opportunities for volunteers to assist us.
It would be year-round too, right?
Year-round
opportunities.
Yeah.
Now, we were, people think when you're going through one of these that you can interact with the animals, you can touch them and hold them. That's, as much as we would love to do that, that's not the case here,
That's
right?
definitely not the case.
No.
They're wild animals. We want to mimic their wild habitat to keep them that way. We do have enrichment programs that would allow them to mimic some of that behavior,
right.
Whether it's through diet, whether it's through props. or whatever, that's great. The only area that people can contact our wildlife is in the Home Hardware's family farm, where there's domestic animals that, again, still domestic. Kids never have a chance to right. get close to domestic animals yeah. or pet a goat or a donkey or a llama.
Yeah.
We have rabbits, pot-belly pigs. We have a lot of different wildlife like that, animals like that that are domesticated.
And they're accustomed.
And they're accustomed to that. So,
right. So that's nice to know.
Yeah, it
that's
is. So nice if you want to you wanna grab a brush and go pet some goats and whatever,
yep.
you're welcome to do that.
Is there another area in the park that you'd like to showcase?
Well, there's lots of areas. I don't know we have time to do everything today, but let's take a walk over and see Thunder. He's our male elk, and he's got a whole herd of females there.
Lucky Thunder.
Lucky Thunder. Well, here we are coming up to our elk herd, and this is Thunder. He's our male. He's 9 years old now. He was born in the Calgary Zoo.
Now, is he and a he small was elk? Aren't elk really big?
Well, actually, you'd be surprised. You know, they're a lot larger than they appear.
Oh.
Once he lifts his head up and his rack fully grows, and you can see how high he can reach because that's how high the branches are cut off, where he likes to trash them around.
Now, that fuzz on his...
The velvet. Yep.
You can tell I'm not a hunter.
Yep.
From the velvet on there, does that stay on there all year?
No, as his antlers develop and grow... throughout the year, once they've reached the size that they're going to be, the velvet will start coming off. That's just actually to protect the bone marrow as it's growing.
So every year he grows new antlers?
Every single year he grows new antlers, and they grow at a rate of 1 centimeter a day. So they grow insanely fast. Like this growth here is only 2 months old.
Oh my!
Yeah, it's pretty
and
cool.
And moose too? They do that too?
Moose do that too.
Oh my god!
Yep. That's the difference between antlers and horns. Like a big horn sheep has horns. A mountain goat has horns. They're permanent, but moose and elk, they have antlers they'll shed them in early spring and then regrow them back.
And every year do they grow bigger?
Every year they grow bigger.
Every year so they this grow year, more points.
Yep. Last year he was an 8 point, which is fairly large.
Yeah.
So this year he's going to be, you know, probably an 8 point again and a few little nubs. He's a pretty cool animal.
And all the fur that's coming off them, that just falls off?
Yeah. It's
and
just,
then they're just
it's just
beautiful.
Their winter coat.
Yeah.
You know, they're shedding their winter coat, so they look a little scraggly right now. You'll see that they'll be rubbing up against the trees yeah. And then the bark to try and rub some of that off because it does get a little itchy. But it won't be long, and his antlers will be in full glory, and he'll be shedded. And
Mother Nature at her best.
Mother Nature will take care of it.
You bet. So, Glenn, I know there's a lot of other animals here, and my sister is just chomping at the bit to get into...
Great.
So we're going to take a short break, and we'll be back in a minute, you and Cindy.
Okay, awesome.
And we're back. I'm here with Glenn, and we're going to take over and see a few of the animals. We've left Lori back there in the monkey cage with her family. Come with us. Let's see
that?
What we have.
Okay.
Now we're here with the wolves. Can you tell us a little bit about the wolves?
Well, there's lots of information about these wonderful wolves. They're three Arctic wolves, which is a family of the gray wolf. Mm-hmm. And they were born in a facility in...
Coming out.
It's coming out right now, just because they wanted to hear us talk about them.
Yeah.
They were born at Park Safari in Quebec.
Oh, wow.
The interesting part is when they arrived here, they're about a year and a half old when they got to us. The first year and a half, all they knew was French. See, a lot of people they're so that's a funny transition for our keepers to go back and retrain them all to the different voice commands,
mm-hmm.
because they're used to understanding it all their commands in the French language, and now we're translating it back. So now they're bilingual.
Yes, exactly.
so that's kind of cool in Canada to have a bilingual wolf.
Wolf, oh yes.
Yeah.
Look,
so it's good. So they've been here about a year now. There's two brothers and a sister, so they're all in the same family. They absolutely love it here. When they first got here, they were a little skittish. Obviously, new surroundings, temperature-wise, everything was a little bit different. But they're quite happy. They're very visible. So they're a cool addition to the park, that's for sure.
Oh, aren't they? Look at how beautiful he is.
He's wonderful. They're quite curious. You know, a lot of the wildlife here, you'll stop by underneath the shade of the tree a little bit. But a lot of the wildlife here are, we do keep them wild as much as we can, obviously, but they're curious and they see a lot of people coming and going, and when folks are walking by, they usually poke their head out to say, hey, who's here to see me?
Okay, and where are we going to next?
Well, there's lots to see. We can walk past the black bears, and from there we'll go down and see Cherry or Moose.
Excellent, sounds great.
Okay,
let's go.
Let's go for a walk.
So we're gonna go see some bears, aren't
we? Yep, we're gonna see the bears. But on the way, actually, here's Bloom, our little badger. Look at it, rolling around in the sun and having a little bit of fun. They look so cute, but they're a pretty vicious animal.
Are they?
Yes, they are. They're very vicious. But again, this is, they're a true hibernator. So all of this enclosure that you see, and they dig, oh my God, can these guys dig. He can dig a hole, or she, pardon me, she can dig a hole faster than you can dig it with a shovel.
Really?
Yep, if you're gonna dig, look at her, just love her, play with her sticks. There's a whole series of tunnels. You can see right here, there's a tunnel.
Yes, I can see a tunnel.
There's tunnels all throughout this area. It used to be landscaped, but I tell you, she wants to dig it all up, fine. Let her dig it up. That's her natural.
Now, would I find
natural...
some of those at my house?
You'll find some of them around Kamloops.
Yeah.
Merritt, all through down into the Lower Mainland. You'll find them.
Oh, they are there,
yeah,
right?
Well, not that many in the Lower Mainland, but you will find them throughout British Columbia. So because they dig so much, what you see as an enclosure above the ground is exactly what's below the ground. So this whole area was excavated. We built a chain link fence, has a chain link floor, and then backfilled it all, and then built the stuff on top. So, but if she wanted to dig, she could come up in the middle of the black bear exhibit or in the middle of the wolves, which is across the road. You never know where, once she starts digging, you never know where it's gonna end. But anyway, she's pretty cool.
Oh, isn't she cool? Okay, and now we're going to...
We're going to head up here. Just off to our right is our black bears. We are hiding in the back there, again, where it's a little bit more shady.
Yes.
In the back, but...
Do they like water?
Oh, do they ever love water. They love that pond. And this water actually flows all the way down into the moose enclosure. So this little waterfall here creates a creek, and then it's multi exhibited. So it goes through the coyotes, which is across the road, and then it goes into the moose pond, and from the moose it goes into the lynx, and from the lynx it goes into the cougar. So it's a natural water supply that that looks after all the wildlife on this east side of the park. Again, being a nice, warm, sunny day, you can see they like to hang back there where it's a little bit more shady.
Yes.
We will be building some shade shelters in here to entice them to come up a little closer.
Right on. And there, you said there's three over there?
There's three, yeah. And the cool thing is with having Clover, being a black bear that's white, in this habitat, there's one male who's as black as you can get.
Mm-hmm.
And then the two females are more of a cinnamon color. So it shows all the different variations. When you talk about a black bear, black bears aren't black.
Yes.
There's about six different shades of black bears.
I just thought they were black.
Nope. A lot of people do.
Yeah.
So that's just a subspecies name.
Mm-hmm.
So it is kind of cool to see all the different color variations of all the bears that we have.
Now, can you bring in little cubs here? If they found a cub that was hurt, could you guys bring it here?
Yes, that's how all three of these got here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, actually, Hamilton was an orphan from northern Alberta that was brought to us. And then the other two, one came from the Merritt area and one came from around Chilliwack.
Oh, right.
So we don't do bear rehab, but if there's an orphan and we have space for it, we can do that.
You'll
Most bear them. Rehab is done in Smithers at Northern Lights Rehabilitation Center. So they look after bear rehab.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Okay, and now where are we going?
Well, from here, we're going to head down the road a little bit and we'll come across our moose cherry.
Our moose cherry.
Little detour on our way to Cherry the Moose. We just stopped by quickly to take a look at these coyotes. They're kind of a cool animal. They're probably the most prolific wildlife that you're going to find around Kamloops. They're everywhere. We got wild ones just on the other side of the fence that visit the park after hours.
Yeah.
That like to come down in here. Anyway, these were orphan grizzly bears. They came from the Yukon Territory. Their names are Dawson and Canute. They're a brother and sister.
So he knows she's the food lady.
Oh, absolutely.
They're following her.
Yeah, they will follow her anywhere. The keepers are very familiar with, or all the animals are very familiar with their specific keepers.
Yeah.
These guys, unfortunately, their mother was destroyed. And again, they were orphaned. We got them when they were 6 weeks old. So they were both quite small, about the size of a dog. They were about 15 pounds each when we first got them. They both came together in a small dog crate when they got flown into Vancouver. They're now 500, 600 pounds. They're 5 years old. They're going to still continue to grow for another couple of years. They'll probably top out about 800 pounds.
Oh my goodness.
So it's amazing how fast these guys grow. And if people are around and they take a look at their habitat here, they'll notice how much they actually dig and how much they are, and how strong they are, the rocks that they're moving around and the size of their claws, the holes that they can dig is amazing.
Wow.
So but they are pretty cool. And right now, as if you can see back there where they are, they're going through a different training session with the keeper. So one has got her paw,
yes,
that's up onto the cage.
Yes.
That's what she gets, a few treats of grapes. That's one of her favorites. But now when the vets are here and they need to take a look at them, they can go through this same exercise and they can see if there's any problems with the pad, if they're limping, is there an issue, if they need to be sedated. They'll come over, they'll present their hip that, you know, they can take a sedation needle. So
look at those claws.
The training that Danielle does with these guys pays off in spades when it comes to their daily care.
Yes.
With the vets. That's for sure.
But, oh, aren't they beautiful?
Yeah, they certainly are.
Like, you really could just go in there and just hug them. Yeah. You know? You could.
You could, but
yeah.
I wouldn't.
No.
Yeah. I don't have to run faster than the bear, I just have to run faster than you.
And you can probably run faster than me.
But it is amazing. Once they're out and you can see them wrestling and just foraging around the enclosure is actually pretty cool.
But you don't have any born here?
None of them are born here. No, we're not set up for breeding. And again, there's an awful lot to doing breeding programs, especially with bears. Once the female has a cub, you'd have to separate the male and the female apart and keep mom and cub in a certain area. Because what the males will do is they'll kill the cub so that female come and heat again and he'll mate again.
Oh, goodness.
So it's not very pleasant.
No,
so
no.
If you're not set up to do it properly,
don't
do it at all.
Mm-hmm.
And again, with these two being siblings, being brother and sister, we definitely wouldn't. Even if we were set up for breeding, we wouldn't do that with these particular bears.
Yeah.
So he's been fixed right now just to make sure that there's no accidents.
Yes.
And
just phenomenal.
Yeah. So now she's getting ready to let them out into their enclosure for the day.
Oh, that's just fantastic.
Yeah. So you'll see the first thing they'll do is once they get out, they'll come around and they'll come right up to the pond. So if you come over this way, you'll watch them as they come out. It's a little bit less of a, now they want to climb the fence.
Look at them up in the fence.
That last gate is open in the corner.
Yeah.
So that's the shifting. So there's different areas in which we can lock him up. Here he comes. He'll come running up here right to the pond. He can't wait to get in that water. Well, this is the female that's coming closer. As you can see the size difference between the male and the female.
Yes, there is a size difference, yeah. But other than that, you really can't tell, can you?
No, it's just, you can just tell by their size. If you came across this in the wild, you'd think it was you wouldn't know if it was a young male or female.
No.
But him, on the other hand, it's
big.
A whole different story.
Oh, look at
him. He loves that pond.
Oh my gosh, isn't this sweet?
I'm gonna play here all day.
I'd like to thank you, Glenn, for letting us come with you for the day. It was absolutely phenomenal being in here. I just love it.
Well, it was absolutely my pleasure. I'm glad you had a chance to walk around the park a little bit and see some of the wildlife that we have to offer and learn a little bit about the park.
Yes.
And I encourage your viewers to come out and do the same.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of great things that we're doing here that we love to share.
I'm going home and getting my little grandsons and I'm bringing them back.
There you go.
Oh, Cindy, you should see these little gaffers in here.
There's little baby ducks.
Oh my God, you can hear them just peeping, peeping.
Isn't that beautiful?
So, Sin.
Yes.
You showed a little bit of your wild side today.
Yes, I did, Lori.
Yeah.
And you met some of your family today.
No monkeys here, Sin.
Yeah, but there was a grizzly bear, and you do have some grizzly bears in your family.
Oh, yeah.
Especially in the morning.
I do for sure. So, yeah, this is just a little hidden gem, Cindy.
It's beautiful here, isn't it?
I think that the only time I was ever here really was in elementary school, and I think they still have a school program that brings children here so that they can come and learn all this.
Well, that's what he said. Yes, they can come here and they can be taught things. Because you just, the information that we learned today.
56 years old, I learned things.
Yes.
So I bet I know what you're going to be doing soon.
I am going home and I'm going to get my little grand boys and I am bringing them back to the wildlife park in Kamloops.
I know. I'm probably going to be doing the same thing soon. So, until next time,
I'm Cindy.
And I'm Lori.
We're keeping up with the Jones girls.